before they finish setting up, I want to say that today I will be focusing on the side of the free trade issue or the neoliberalism or globalization, which I hadn't had much chance to talk about in the past few days. So today, I'm not a spokesperson of the Sunflower Movement. I'm just a student activist. So this is the opinion of mine, not the movement, because the Sunflower Movement has never, the free trade has never been a main topic or issues during the movement, but it is one of them, but it's not the main discourse. So, okay, this is the PowerPoint that I had in Taiwan for an occasion, from 2,000 people to 500,000, and that's not important. Okay. Okay. So I will just skip it. This is the activity that we had before. And I think everybody knows about ECFA, so the service trade agreement is under the framework of ECFA, so I just skip that. And the four form of the service trade agreement is as listed: cross-border trade, consumption abroad, commercial presence of natural person. Well, it's just not important. Just remember, a lot of capital slavers, or well, not slavers, they say they call it bosses, or come to Taiwan, and capitals can be invested up to 50% something, or yeah. So it's just, I will skip that. It's difficult. I think that, okay, I just need next. Okay, just skip all that. This, because I will, if you want, I will give this PowerPoint to, okay, wait. Go back, sorry, go back.
Yes.
Okay, I'm talking about the some dimensions, or we can see in the service trade agreement. First of all, is the China factor, just like my teacher Shen said about, it's about the sovereignty of Taiwan, or whether or not if we sign or we pass this agreement, our freedom of speech will be affected, or will this benefit the cross-strait politician or international capitalist alliance, which just benefit them and not to ordinary people. And another side is the economic justice, which we talk about what is the impact on the industry during the whole deregulation process, and can we reach the class justice, and we want to break the myth of the free trade. And another side, of course, is the pressure justice. We talk about black box operation, and the lack of monitoring system, and the no impact assessments. And the last one is the form and the content of the agreement. Well, for example, some economics says, well, this is just not a good free trade agreement because they are not opening up enough, and we are opening up too much. It's not equal. But this side of discussion is not too much during this movement. It's mainly about presidential justice and the China factor. And today I'm trying to focus more on the economic justice and next. And this is just China factor, and I not intend to do that today. Next. Okay, also, what's behind the whole service trade agreement is the concept, or not concept, the practice of free trade. So you can see free trade, and I don't like the term free trade that much because it sounds good. And well, maybe it's good, but just we need to. I like to use another term called deregulation, and well, that's just one part of the free trade I know. And so with China, that's the ECFA framework, and you can see the service trade agreement, or later on will be the trade agreement in goods. And with other countries, we have FTA and TPP or RCEP. So. Well, we are, Taiwan is now on the free trade is the agenda of Taiwan now. So you can see the President Ma Ying-jeou wants Taiwan to be an island of freedom, which he meant island of free trade. Yeah, sure. Okay, next. Okay, so I want to define the term of free trade. In my perspective, I see that in the way of deregulation, which means in the international or regional trade activities, they try to reduce all kinds of trade barriers to improve the mobility of goods or labor force or capitals and such product factors. So those trade barrier include tariff barrier or non-tariff barrier. I believe you all are aware of that. So we try to lower the tariff, or we want to eliminate all the quota control, or there can be no license subsidies or something. It just needs to eliminate all the trade barriers. And also, under the agenda of free trade, the laws of environmental protection, or the laws of labor protection, or the laws of the land appropriation, they have to be loosened so that it won't be a barrier to the trade. So you can see that this is a very big picture. So it's not just about service trade, it's about the whole landscape of our ways of life. Okay, next. So the service trade agreement is just one part of the whole agenda of deregulation. Why is that? Because the service trade agreement will just, they allow Chinese capital or workers or capitalists to come to Taiwan with little limits, and they also allow Chinese capitalists to control the transportation, warehouse, or logistic. So if we pass this agreement and later on we pass the trade agreement in goods, then it will become like Taiwan and China will, the labor force, the capitalist, and the goods, and the material, and the capital, all those essence to produce will become, they can freely move around between Taiwan and China, and which is the whole spirit of free trade. So this is, if there will be the free trade economy zone and in Taiwan. So we will just, on this agenda, Taiwan will just increase our dependence on China, and also increase the degree of deregulation. Yeah, and next. But this is not a new thing, or shall I say, this is not the medicine to solve the problem of Taiwan's economy. Why? Because Taiwan has already been on the process of deregulation. You can see that in 1970s, we already tried to lower our tariff rate. And from now on, and next. So you can see this is the percentage of the tariff that is in our net text. So in 1970s, there is up to 30%. That means tariff is a tariff is a major has a major proportion in our text. But in 2010 or something, they'll just drop to nearly 4%. So this is a process that we were already on. So next. But what is the outcome of this process? We can say that the deregulation can be said is the benefit to the big corporation and bad things for labor. Because if we see that the primary distribution of GDP, and you can see the compensation of employees, and the net indirect taxes is just dropping, and the operation surplus is rising, which means the government and the labor is they gain little during this process, the whole process. Those who get the benefit are the big businesses. So another thing is the index of unit output labor cost of employees, and the index of labor productivity, which means Next week, there is the yeah. So you can see the green one is the which simply to put it simply is the in GDP how much is going back to the employers, to the workers, to the laborers. Well, there were it was about around 50%, but it now dropped to the 49%. And then the purple line here was is the surplus of the business. So it rise from 70% to about around 74-73%. So it's not that much, but compared to what the labor or say the employers is just, well, yeah, you know what I'm saying. Yes, and the blue one, which is the this one, is the how much the state, how much the government will gain from the GDP, from taxes, from tax, from tariff, something like that. So, well, this trend just shows how the big picture is in Taiwan. Next, and this is the orange one is the index of labor productivity, which means Taiwanese labor is very productive. You can see the line just raising, and the green line is how much the employee is going to pay for each unit of productivity, which you can just imagine it as wages or something. So it just dropped, and meanwhile this is the productivity is rising. So I just put it this way: the harvest of what the laborers or the workers have worked so hard and to increase our GDP just didn't come back to them and just goes to the big business. Okay, next. Go back. And another one. Go back. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is under the economic liberalization and deregulation or whatever you want to call it, the industry facing tremendous competition pressures. That is what is going to happen when the service trade agreement is passed. So under the circumstances, the minority of the labor force will become the first one to be cut or to be sacrificed. So we can see that during Taiwan's history of economic development, a lot of factories, they just shut down or moved to overseas, just like teacher Shen said, and or to send away to dismiss the laborers or back pay, part-time job increases. Okay, and our real wages just stop for 15 years. And on the other side, the country, the government, they use something called statute for the encouragement of investment or the statute of upgrading industry, which means to lower the tax rate or give them money to try to give incentive to the business to invest in Taiwan, but this didn't help much help Taiwan's economy much, because they just get the money or they pay less tax and still move to move overseas, and or they won't actually upgrade their technologies. They just there's not actual upgrade during the whole period, but the wage earners, they have to bear more and more tax, and it's out of proportion. Okay, next. So what's the impact of service trade agreement to Taiwanese teenager? Okay, we can see there's a trend that from 1980s from now, the proportion of the service industry is just rising, and it's now about 70% of our GDP and 60% of our population. And in the service industry, there the accommodation and the catering business and the wholesale and the retail trade is add up to 48%, And their average real wages in 2012 is less than 40,000 dollars in Taiwanese Taipei, which is less than about 15. Okay, I don't do that. I don't do that math. I'm not good in math. Yeah, well, it's just not that much. And the financial business, the information and communication, or the science or the technology service, they are just about 20% of the industry, but their average real wage is about 6 or 7, 6-7 today. Yeah, so this is so you can see that if we open this market, there will be business who have the benefit, or maybe a
I'm your side, so let me explain one thing. Is okay, he's talking about the average income of Taiwanese, which is 3 times higher than the average income of Chinese people, and the treaty was involved of our Taiwanese job opportunity about 7 million people, and Chinese GDP is 10 times higher than the Taiwanese GDP. China's GDP is world number one, and Taiwan's the number 7. But in the meantime, our average income is 3 times higher than the Chinese people. And we are signing a service treaty involving 7 million of our people to, you can see our income is already 3 times higher than them. And
okay. Okay. Well, what I'm trying to say here is that inside Taiwan, inside the Department of Service Industry, it's several. You can see, you have to see the diversities, and some of the industries are just they are vulnerable to the impact, or they are vulnerable to the opening up. So we have to consider, we have to have consideration on those, for example, accommodation or catering business. And of course, the financial information, they will have benefit. But I think the whole point to rethink the concept of free trade is how much, to what degree, to what content we are going to sacrifice our minority to give the benefit to the 1%, 5%. Yes, I think that's the concept. And just very quick, in 2012, or there's a survey on the teenager or young people's jobs category, and there are 57% young people are in the service trade industry, and the most largest proportion will still be on the wholesale and the retail trade, about 30%, and the average wage is below $30,000. And also Taiwan, service industry in Taiwan are mainly medium or small business, and when it's opened up and facing the big corporation, big state capitalist, big business, you'll just be overwhelmed, and the cost of competition might just transfer to just goes to our young laborers, and just causing the poverty of our young generation, or deepen the class injustice in Taiwan. So we have to think, the government just keep talking about the ability to compete, but who has the ability to compete is always those who already can compete, and those who cannot compete will just be compete away. Yes. And next. Okay, so this is probably the last one. You know, we have to think now, in this whole trend of globalization, or the whole press of liberalization, free trade, we have to think that what's the cost of each individuals, or each actors, or each industries in this free trade or liberalizations. You can see among all the 生产要素, factors of factors of production, among all factors of production, the labor force has the lowest mobility. The land can be purchased and switched to other person, to other corporation, so it can shift easily. But the labor force cannot move cannot move freely, because for example, that in Taiwan there is a 国道 收费员 that who charges on the highway, and they were dismissed, and the big company said, okay, you can come work in my company, and you don't have to worry about losing your job. But the technology, the skill that is required is totally different. So the government always say, if we open up, we'll create thousands of job opportunities. In the, for example, technology department or communication service department, but those who open a small or medium retail shop, you just cannot go work in the financial department right away. It will cost years of training or retraining. So we have to think that what's the cost or what's the price we have to pay or we can bear during the whole process of liberalization, and to what extent we are willing to sacrifice our minority people, our minority friends. So, this is the issues that hadn't been discussed much during the whole sunflower movement. But me personally, I want this dimension of issues to be widely discussed. I'm not saying that we have to go the way to anti the free trade, or we are just shut. We just don't sign any trade agreement, but this kind of discussion is neat, and it's good for the good for Taiwan. And the whole point of the sunflower movement is to have the due process or have the space for citizen deliberation. There can be more discussion. So with that, we can have this kind of discussion whether or not we are going to on this way, or we can change our course to another direction. So yeah, that's pretty much what I'm going to say today.